Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Nice to see you again. Still interested?
Hello, everyone. Hope you feel
hello,
fine.
Good afternoon. Hello, Natalia.
Hello, hello. Today my camera will be off. I'm sorry for that, but I'm still here.
No problem. It's important to have mine open, so otherwise, yeah, we'll not be able to get everything right. We'll still wait a little longer, yeah, to give the chance to everyone to join if they want. And then we'll start. Okay, I think we can start even if we don't have such a big audience, but being recorded, you can also see it again if you want or recommend it, whatever. So this second topic after the introduction, I've done it Monday. It's about depth of field and sensor size and the differences between the cameras, because when we want to make some pictures or shoot a movie or shoot something, home movie, let's say, not a movie, we always judge the camera quality or how performant it is regarding with what we expected to have after all. And one of the main let's say aesthetical approaches in visual content, it's the depth of field. The depth of field, it's very easy to approach when we have a camera which it has a big sensor, at least APS-C or even full frame. If you saw the presentation video for this topic, I presented in the video four cameras. One which is a point and shoot, this Canon camera, which is a very basic one. And of course, it's not such an expensive camera. The famous iPhone or smartphone. I would say it's an iPhone because it's a brand. A mirrorless camera, which is APS-C, and full frame camera, which is a DSLR. Of course, every one of those cameras has different specifications and different prices for each of those. Sometimes, or at least on the recent times, when you buy a smartphone, sometimes it's more expensive than a camera like that with a lens on it. So depends on how passionate and interested you are on making photographs or video content. You have to start with deciding which type of camera you want to use. And beside of that, the specification of the camera, they're very important, because that's the look you're going to get after certain choices you have or you make during the this moment of choosing one camera or the other one. If we talk about how different those pictures they're gonna look like, regarding the depth of field, of course, they're gonna look totally different because of how these pictures are gonna be, let's say, showed, or what we shoot is gonna look totally different than usual. Why? Because in regular daily basis, we're not seeing any blurry background, and this blurry background, which is of course connected with shallow depth of field, it's an aesthetical approach on what we want to shoot and how the subject or the character we shoot it is going to be showed in the space we use. As an example, in the video I made, there's a moment of explaining how the field of view, it's related with the focal length of the camera, and also it's related with the sensor you have. So as I told you, we have totally different cameras. This one, it has a focal length starting from 5 to 40, which is kind of medium to long lens. This one is an 85 on a mirrorless, and this is a 24 to 105 on DSLR. DSLR, this acronym comes from a digital single lens camera. And it's because we can view the picture through the lens itself. So this prism here allows this direct viewing of the picture we want to take it, and it's coming from the oldest camera, which originally they made on film, and they've been also SLR, so single lens reflex camera. So just to show the differences on the, let's try to make. So the differences between the sensors, of course, it's obviously, yeah, this is a small sensor, which is not that small. And this is a big sensor, which is very big. When the mirror is moving, you can see the sensor. I don't want to expose the sensor to the light because it's not such a, this camera is more reliable than old, that's an old DSLR, so I don't want to make it spoil it something. There's some, well, that's good. Anyway, so those DSLR cameras, of course, they're older than mirrorless. The big difference is how to see and view the picture you're going to take it. On a DSLR, as I told you, you can view the picture you're going to take it through the prism. So you have the viewing system active because this mirror here shows the frame you're going to take it. Yeah. So the exposure, it's the moment when the mirror is up and the sensor is exposed. So that's the moment when the whole thing is done. So on the other hand, the mirrorless cameras, which are very popular those days and are very spectacular on specifications, you can have the live view on the camera. And because, let me put it on the automatically. And of course, the live view allows you to see the frame you're going to take it on this screen here. Yeah, so this is a very tight lens. There's an 85. Anyway, I can change it with a wider lens. Anyway, all the features we expect to change in the camera, they're on this screen here. So we can change the type of how we change the t-stop. This stop is not changing here because the lens is not a genuine Sony. I will change it with a Sony. And all the things you want to change it in the camera can be adjusted through the display here. Now we are on the high ISO, which is not good for any pictures because it brings the noise into the picture. We also can change the t-stop, which is here. You can get in closer or wider. This is a lens with a 2.8 widest t-stop. And also we can change the exposure time. So the exposure time starts from 30 seconds and goes up to 1 by 2000, something like that, 4000. So there is a very short exposure time, and also the range, the t-stop range starts from 2.8 and goes to 22. So the difference is between having a wider aperture comparing with a not so wide aperture on the lens, it's about the quality of the lens. Yeah, so this lens, which is an 85, has the widest aperture on 1.8, which is less than T2. This lens here, which is also a prime lens, which is not a zoom, it's a 20 with 2.8. It's not such an expensive one, but looks pretty good for what a lens can do. Anyway, regarding the field of view, depth of view, field, and the quality of the lens, we can I can share the screen for show how the depth of field it's changing when we change the sensor size and the camera. I will start first with first depth of field, which is The picture is taken at T18. You can see the focus is on the tip of the nose of the Moses. This is taken at T4, and the last one it's taken at T16. So this is a light, LED light, which is placed behind the character, the model. And the difference is between the depth of field on 4, 16 and 1/8. It's shown in this detail here, which is clearly seen in this. So that's the insert of the same picture. And you can see, even if from the, there's a very big distance between the light and the model, we can also see the details of the lights here on the T16, not so well on T4, and very, very not clear on T18. So those are differences on the depth of field and how the lens itself, according with the sensor size and the camera specifications, will render this kind of depth of field issue. So the depth of field, as I told you, it's in my opinion, and that's not only me who says that, that's a very important thing to have in mind when we take pictures, because if the pictures are not the meaning when we do that, making pictures is not, let's say, a domestic one, like making holiday pictures or whatever. But even if you want to take pictures with the kids, with your kids, or who knows, some events, you're going to make it in the family and with friends, there's always good to have in mind something like at least borrow a camera and do and know what to do with it when you know the specification of the camera. So this depth of field, of course, it's very influenced by the camera sensor size, and as big as the sensor is, the shallow the depth of field goes. So on the same t-stop, as I told you, this camera has a t-stop widest, it's 3.2, which is a little open than 4 on the widest, and 7 on the tightest lens. If we shoot at the same composition with identical t-stops, as the sensor goes bigger, the depth of field is shallower. And there's a nice explanation on there is a, I'll show you now, a website. Which I'm gonna share it now, where we can have the explanations in depth for all the things we expect to or want to see on the cameras, like here, focal length and aperture, aperture, ISO, then shutter speed, the triangle, reciprocity triangle of the things, and whatever, everything you want to, portrait lighting, how you can place the light, why one light it's better than the other one, the position of the lights, how we can change and do a pleasant look of the model instead of having a horror approach on the same type of photograph. So the site is camragingcolor.com. Sorry, there's another color. It's the American version. There's a U added there. Anyway. So there's a lot of tutorials and testimonials on the website. Of course, you finally you have to do the pictures, and when you start to do those pictures, you have to have at least the basic knowledge on what the focal length means, why one camera it's cheaper than the other one. Why do you want to choose a mirrorless instead of DSLR and so on and so forth? As I told you, even on the introductory meeting, it's not always a matter of how performant the camera is. It's also who's going to take the pictures and how we're going to do that story through pictures and shooting, let's say, home movies, because sometimes we can see very interesting results done even with smartphone, because the processors which are involved inside the smartphones or cameras are of course made to please the consumer, doing a very pleasant look of the pictures, like increasing the saturations, do some different let's say applying different LUTs, which is the pictures. We're going to look sometimes sharper or sometimes softer. We can adjust this kind of softness or sharpness inside the camera. But those basic adjustments are not made to the, let's say, consumer cameras or prosumers. This mirrorless is not a consumer camera, it's a prosumer. Even if it's not such a expensive camera, it's I would say that's pretty cheap. It's not expensive, but what he's done, it's very impressive in a way. And also all the mirrorless cameras, sometimes there some of the mirrorless cameras in those days are used as professional shooting cameras because of the look they will give to the image you're gonna shoot. So you might be surprised to find out some movies which have been screened in Berlin or big festivals around the world, being shot on mirrorless cameras. And of course, the reason why they've been shot on mirrorless cameras was based on tests and the aesthetic decision on how that movie has to be, in a way, of how the look is gonna look and how the film is gonna be shot. So that's, of course, a different story about this kind of approach. Sorry, a bit. Okay, well, so of course if we want to judge or look at the pictures I've shot it with those four cameras, they're not dramatically different. So sometimes we might tell, okay, I don't need such a expensive camera or very complicated or performant camera because I might be confused or I don't want to have too many knobs to turn on. I just need a camera which is just doing by itself all the things I should do it, and I don't want to bother too much with how those things they're going to be done by me or by the camera. But sometimes I think it's worth it to try that because the results are of course very different, and it is let's say a reason for which the professionals are sometimes choosing between two different cameras which are not very similar as performances. They're choosing because the camera itself, it's capturing the space where you're gonna photograph or shoot in a specific way. So some of the let's say the ways of changing the look, it's about how we're going to choose the camera itself. Because of this kind of approach, even if we talk about studio photographs or commercial type photographs like wedding or sometimes let's say glossy type of photographs, the photographer or the artist itself, it's choosing a different kind of camera for specific let's say final products. Sometimes because the reason of doing commercial photographs for ads or advertising, we need to use different kind of cameras, very professional type of cameras, which are of course different sizes and different prices on let's say on the market. But that's a totally different topic. I don't want to explain it here because it's totally different to make a picture for a magazine and make a picture mesh up for a building. So you have to use a different camera and a different specifications, let's say it. Now I will try to get back to the video. I share it and get to that moment when I took the pictures here, which is 6:12 somewhere here. Let's see if we can see the I'll try to start again the video to see again the environment and to compare with the results on the photographs, talking about this topic of depth of field and field of view, which are two different issues. Well, doesn't want to load again. I will try to open up again. Well, doesn't want to start anyway. I just wanted to get back to the moments I took the pictures just to remember the environment I made all those pictures in, which is a photo studio at our university, which is not a big one, but we have the lights and let's say the models to experiment the different situations there, either if it's just for lighting or explaining how the depth of field and the field of view, the lens on the focal length, we're gonna it's gonna work on different cameras. Well, doesn't start anyway. Okay, so getting back to this topic of how the lenses and the t-stop will gonna change the perspective. Of course, the depth of field, it's one of the reason why we want to use a better lens instead of a zoom lens, which usually doesn't have such a good aperture range from the widest to the tightest. So as low the widest goes, better it is for changing the way of how the environment it's showed. So I will show you some pictures here with open up. I will show some pictures I've made it this summer in my room here. They might not be that interesting, but I will explain why they've what I've done here, and they're black and white, and I use one of my it was a Sony, the mirrorless camera, and show how the atmosphere in the room can be changed by exposure and light direction. This is the first one, this is the second one, this is the third one. So the difference between those three, it's just the exposure between the room and the subject, which is me in this case. And if we want to, let's say, express and show the atmosphere in natural atmosphere, let's say, in the room, which is this room, by the way, we can relay on the effect we have it visible through the window. But sometimes it's not enough, the effect. You have to add it another one and try to make it better exposure or differences in the lighting. So I will start again with the exposure on the background, different underexpose, corrected expose, and the differences between those pictures are just the exposure and the intensity of the things we see in the background. And of course, the atmosphere, the natural atmosphere as we expected in this room, if we want to expose for exterior light, it would be like this, or with some lights added like this, or even better like this. So this, of course, it's about how to balance the intensity and exposure relevance from an interior watching or balancing to the exterior shots, which in my case it's what we can see it on the window there, and also the white balance, which is of course a mixed lighting. Here we have this light which is lighting my face, which is a warm light, and the exterior light, of course, it's comparing with this sun, it's a cold light. It's called colder, and it's having a higher color temperature, which is around 6,000 kelvins. Anyway, this is a topic for a further class. I will get back to what the lenses and the camera we can make it as a composition. So of course, as I show you in the material Monday, the field of view, it's important because through this field of view and the relevance of the lens, we can change the feeling of the background and how the elements from on the background will gonna look when we change that thing in between. So if you remember, I just showed this Monday. It's an example of how the space and the perspective it's changing just from the camera position and the lens we're gonna use. On the top three pictures, we've changed the lens, the focal length from 18 to 100 to 200, and on the bottom photographs, they're just the same point of view. The camera doesn't change the position, and it was shot with the same lens, the 18 the widest and the 200 the tightest, but I just made a crop into this one and it looks like this one. So as a feeling, of course, when we look at the space, when we keep the same position with the first element of the composition, the feeling is totally different. When we change the position of the camera, it happens that if we don't change the position of the camera and we just crop inside the composition made with an 18 comparing with a 200, the perspective is similar. So the changing of perspective, of course, it's depending on the sensor size and the field of view. And also this changing of perspective, it's depending on camera position, because if we don't change the camera position, we can't really change the perspective as you expected, and as I show you. Also, the this changing of perspective, as I told you Monday, it's sometimes used in the movies, and it's called dolly zoom move, which I already showed you in the days of the Road to Perdition of Sam Mendes movie from 1990 something, 2000, whatever. It's a kind of recent movie, it's not from old time movies. Okay. Getting in depth with this topic, which is not such a spectacular one, but it's a very easy to feel the difference between different point of views taken by different lenses on the different camera positions. Of course, we sometimes want to separate the model from the background, but sometimes we just want to include the background into the picture, like the character or the model will blend with the background we shoot on. So as a perceptual meaning of this, of course, we want to take care of not only the point of view, the field of view, and the sensor we're going to shoot on. Is also a matter of how we put the subject in relations with the background. Because if the background is too bright and the subject is not that bright, we're not seeing too well the subject, and then we feel a little bit confused about how the how and why the subject is gonna be projected on that bright background or darker background. Of course, it's a matter of how we change the position and how the light itself will gonna be shown in the composition. But sometimes it's just to underline the subject is just a reason to add a little more light, which is kind of how to give a different feeling when we have a character, like in this picture here, these three pictures, with no light on the face, a little light on the face, and a little more light on the face. So there are three, let's say, cases and, sorry, three positions and three illustration of the same camera position, where the exposure, the differences between the background and the foreground, the actor's position, and how he's underlined and lit, it's make a different, a big difference between the two, three of those. So here it's just with the lights from the light source we see in the frame. Here there's a little more added, and here there's another accent on his face as he's being lit by the light next to him. Anyway, we'll have a different topic on this lighting and mood further on. I think it's going to be next week. This Friday we're going to have a discussion about the composition, so we'll have time to get through the lighting contrast, mood and lighting, and then white balance and color correction. Anyway, so let's make a little break now, a 10 minutes break, and I will prepare some materials to show after the break, and we'll see each other at 5 to 4. Okay, I'm back. I will get back again to the to the exposure and how important exposure is during the how the environment is going to be seen in different situations, they said. So sometimes when we use a very wide t-stop in exterior and the background, it's not so well controlled, we can find ourselves in a situation like this one, which of course it's a matter of how we judge the brightness and the density of the subject related with the background, and how we can change this feeling by changing the exposure or adding an extra light on the face of the character. As you can see it here, we have, of course, in a very bright environment like exterior daylight, which was a very bright sunny day, we want to make a picture with a character, and this character, of course, it's in the shade. Being in the shade, of course, brings that problem of how we balance the exposure differences between the shade and the sunlight, which of course it's a very big difference in the sunny day. And as you can see here, if you want to change the relevance of the exposure on his face, that means we're gonna bring even brighter on the brighter level the background, so which is not such a good thing or idea to do. We need to adjust this brightness in a way of how to see better the character's face and his reaction, and not having a very bright background and the character on a different density and brightness. So as you can see it here, it is the big difference between this kind of let's say a lighting position for him, even if the background doesn't change that much, and this lighting position, and of course this one which is brighter. So this kind of changing, we can make it even with this kind of mirrorless camera by adding a flash in exterior days. I mean, we can remotely use flash and just shoot with the flash, but the flash is better not to be in linked to the camera and on the camera position, because on this position here, of course, it's close to the camera, but it's above the camera, and here it's on the side of the camera on a fairly distant position to the camera. But of course, this this flash which I've used here, it's a soft flash. It's not a very directional quality light, and it makes a big difference between how the portrait looked before we added this light, and we're trying to adjust for the exposure sake this thing, and how this portrait looked in the side light and the top light, which is a frontal top light, is not a very top like in Godfather, the movie I told you about. Anyway, the relevance of the depth of field characteristic on the camera, it might make the difference between how the character it's shown in that environment and not seeing anything about the background, and how this background will start to look different as the density and exposure with bigger depth of field or smaller depth of field. In exposure, normal exposure, a little bit underexposed, a little bit more underexposed, and a little bit more underexposed. So it's a matter of how the exposure and the depth of field will emphasize the differences between the character and the background. And this difference, it's clearly seen with longer lens prime, and of course with big sensors camera type. This, of course, it's not only about depth of field, it's also about the lighting of the portrait in exterior. And this lighting can be very flat and soft, directional from the side, or again, very soft and flat, as you can see it here. And again, we can try to make an extremely different feeling of the environment by exposing differently the same picture. Exposingly correctly exposed, overexposed, again correctly exposed, and getting into more moody style by underexposing. By underexposing in exterior, a sunny day means you have to make a difference and think about how big is the difference between the sun itself, the light, which is, of course, the character is backlit here, and how the shade is gonna be read by the camera. Yeah, here, of course, that's the correct exposure. This is underexposed, and this one it's overexposed, of course. But as I told you, the focus is, of course, different as well. Here is very shallow. You can see his ears are in focus, but the eyes are not. This is a bigger depth of field, and as close we go with the t-stops, we can see better the background and the things here, even if they're very underexposed on the both examples. Here it's softer, here it's much more defined as the texture and characteristic of the background. I forgot to ask if you have any questions till now. If not, I'm going further on.
Could I ask you some?
Absolutely, sure.
Mm. If you don't have a flash, what can you use?
A white card, something which can bounce
not the light.
A white board.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not a mirror.
No, mirror, no, not at all. The mirror is very unpleasant for anybody who will be lit by it, because it's, of course, it's like looking at the sun.
Okay. Should be sharp. Okay.
Yeah, it's very, very unpleasant way of trying to make all the examples here. Some of them, because of the daylight situation, I will get back again to the photographs.
May I ask you something? My question is about this picture with extra exposure. Yeah, it is a defect of shooting, or it might you be used as a artistic approach, as a artistic tool to create this sunny space? Because I don't understand. In some cases, it might be treated as an advantage and not a disadvantage. Thank you.
Well, in a way, this picture was made properly just to discuss about this, because sometimes mm-hmm. if we properly expose, a picture can be very bored. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I prefer this kind of approach when the picture says something about the character. Even, I mean, you don't feel the strength of the sun here. The character is very relaxed, and it doesn't feel like it's in an environment which might be very harsh for him. This is a mm-hmm. different one. It's aesthetically, I prefer the picture which tells you something about the environment and the character you photograph. And this is one of the examples when looking at the different, let's say, backgrounds and lighting, of course, one direction says different mm-hmm. things about the environment and the style you shoot on. So, and sometimes we just hear, of course, we add some light, but it is, as I told you, it was a very soft flashlight, but you can, if it's a sunny day, you can add this kind of bounce by bouncing from the white card, the light. And sometimes you don't need a big one, you just need the, like, I don't know, this kind of, like an A4 white mm-hmm. card. It's not such a big hassle to get to have a little bounce for. Sometimes you just need a shine in the eye, some sparkle in the eye. You just don't need a big light effects to bring the picture to the life.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. And then I will show you kind of in advance thing about the again the exposure, properly exposed things and properly overexposed, or different moods in the same position of the character will tell different stories about it. So I will share the screen now. So those pictures have been made in the studio, of course. I will start with the first one. It's the same model with the same t-shirt. Again, the sometimes, of course, this is it's a mistake here, because the proper exposure is this one here. But as I told you before, sometimes you need to tell something about the character in a tighter shot and on different. And it was a long exposure time, as you can see, it's a little blurred here in the same settings. Yeah, but of course, it's not a best example here because this was overexposed, accidentally overexposed. So talking about the sparkle in the eye, you can see this kind of sparkle which disappears here, because you need because the characters and the, especially on the close shots, you need to feel this glimpse in the eye, because otherwise the character looks dead. Well, if you can add it with a little shiny things close to the camera, not so big, it will be enough to give that little glimpse in the eye. And also here, we can see different approaches on the how the light will change the environment and the character of the model. Yeah, the model will look different in the different lighting because it's lit differently in different positions. So we'll get back to this lighting and mood later on, but talking about the exterior shots and how we can handle the contrast and the lighting in the sunny day, of course we need to compensate the high contrast situations when we shoot outside on a sunny day. And sometimes just a flash on the camera will do that and just reduce the intensity of the flash. You can make this balance very well and feel that glimpse in the character eye, if it's in the shade or the difference between the background and the portrait is too big. Well, again, this kind of approaches are not so complicated, and it's easily to have in mind when you prepare for doing this kind of photographs. When you have in mind this, you might have or take with you a little cardboard, which is a white cardboard, just for the sake of having this kind of bouncing light from different directions, not so flat and straight on to the character, which are not so appealing and flattering for the model. So of course everybody wants to experiment how to make interesting pictures. Sometimes we imagine different things about how the picture is going to look like, but the results are sometimes disappointing because the lights, if the character of the lights is too harsh and the direction is not so flattering for the model, and so on and so forth. So I'm very, let's say, I'm very aware of this kind of different approaches on doing pictures. And of course, if some of us were going to start to do pictures now, they're going to start with some not so high level cameras and lights, and for sure no one will start doing this in the in a studio because it's very expensive and it's not so easy to rent a photo studio and then try to do a lot of let's say photographs and see what happens on different environments. Sorry, I just turned off the desktop. Okay. If there's any more questions, I will happily try to.
Yes, Alex, could I ask you some?
Absolutely, yes. Go for it.
If you want to underline some objects on the photo, like while we are talking about a model, so if you would like to underline his lips or eyes or nose or something, you have to make this line brighter or darker, or could you just do underline it by light, some one object on the photo?
Well, the easiest way of underlining something in the composition, it's make it a little brighter, of course.
Brighter.
Yeah, brighter. If you make it brighter, of course, you need to control that brightness and the area you light it. Because if you just...
But the thing is that brighter may be blurrier.
Not blurry, brighter. Brighter means you just put a light on it.
Yeah, I understand. But it might be blurry also when you put more light on the object.
Well, blurry, what do you mean about blurry?
Well, I mean, not in focus, kind of not in focus, kind of blur.
Okay. Well, usually when you try to underline something in the composition and you put more light on it, of course, that thing or part of the, let's say, of the composition, which is brighter, it has to be in focus. So if you blur all the rest of the composition, will be good to emphasize what you want to look at, or your intention is to underline or emphasize that thing through the depth of field and the lighting. Because in, I will give an example. Let me just show you something here. It's an exercise. I've made it with my my students. I just wanna... And it's kind of explaining how to, let's say, emphasize parts of the composition with lights or partially lit. Just want to get to the exercise was about how we reinterpret painting. We can start from pitch black and try to add volumes and tridimensionality to the background and the character, and adding lights, we're going to tell a different story about the character itself and the environment we're going to shoot on. You see, any light we added, it brings more informations about what you'd like to emphasize. So you want to emphasize her face, of course. We want to emphasize the texture. We want to emphasize the hands and so on and so forth. So by doing this, you try to add meaning to any of those separate things, which at the beginning, they're not at all, you don't have any clues or references about it.
Mm-hmm.
So it was, there's sometimes we'll try to make, I mean, it's more understandable when you do it practically, because it's easy to use in a studio, even if there are flashlights, soft boxes or snorkels or whatever the snots in the soft boxes in the head.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, you can concentrate kind of, let's say, a light on a detail, and then just that means we're going to bring and emphasize that detail in the composition, like I've showed you in that video.
On which program are you doing that?
No, it was shot.
It was just one shot.
Yeah.
And after you you are making it on what kind of editing program? I mean,
well, usually I'm using Lightroom, Aperture Lightroom, but being a DOP, I'm using it Resolve. But I will show you at the end of the. At the end of the thing, I will show you the. Let me show again the pictures. And all the intermediary positions on the composition and the lighting. I need to select them here. Okay. So those are the pictures which are actually part of that video I just showed. And they were just trying to find the right position and how the character will be shown. Just trying different positions and expressions. This is through the viewfinder. The lens flare. This is without the lens flare.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the positions and how different effects and the lighting, and of course, what we're trying to express through the pictures, and it's shown in different positions. And then we've done that video with the light we used to light this whole thing. And the order we use it to make the reinterpretation of the picture. There's a painting we imagine was, I don't know, Virgin Mary, whatever, and we try to make it in a different ways of doing it. Yeah, but that's as I told, it's of course it's easily to make it in a studio, in a photo studio with photo lights like snots and soft boxes. Sometimes it's hard to make this kind of lighting, because the accessories on the photo heads, they're not so various like in a cinema style lighting.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So right now talking about photo shooting, but if I'd like to take some capture from the video, you know why am I asking it? Because I'm a journalist, I'm working as a host on the political program, and after I'm doing some sequences for the website, and I need photo, and I'm taking these kind of screens from the, and putting it on our web and so on. So how to make pictures more how to say it, interesting from the video. I can find that way. It's not my literal job, but whatever. I want to be my also website to work better.
Well, there's a big difference between the video picture and the photo picture, of course, because we have a different contrast, we have a different latitude, the dynamic range on both mediums. But if the resolution of the camera, which it might be full HD, 1920, 1080, it's enough, let's say, and the color range, the color space of the camera, it's quite big or fairly big. You can then from the print screens, you can make let's say more interesting pictures by easily making it black and white. That's the easiest way of doing it. And then working on the programs, adding contrast and vignettes and brightness and you know, all the levels around, making it different than in the video you just showed. Because then for sure the people, they're not interesting to see the same kind of picture from the video, even if they realize they're the same kind of medium, or you already showed it. But if something there is different than in the video, that will make more appealing and more interesting to look at than in real, let's say, life. Like we'll just redo the same thing just on photos, not on videos.
Yeah, because I've got some kind of big stage shooting also, and actually that is what I'm putting on my web. Not on my, but on the Georgian public broadcaster's web. So, but I also want to add some photos. So that's why I'm asking.
Well, the easiest way, I think, it's just to walk around with a mirrorless camera and just take some snapshots. The performances of these cameras are amazing. And if no one is confused about a guy walking around and taking pictures, because they're not loud cameras, they're not like in a DSLR, which the mirror makes a lot of noise. They're just very, very quiet cameras, and just of course, as an aesthetic approach, in my opinion, you have to do totally different than in a video approach. Because in a video approach, either if it's an interview or let's say,
it's an interview. Yeah.
So usually there are interviews which are not very dynamic; they're very static.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
It might be very easy to add, as I told you, further apart from the place from the interview, just having guy taking some snapshots with a longer lens, that we're going to look better for sure than any, let's say, print screens, and trying to make it look like really high quality products. And I think from a journalist point of view, sometimes it's nice to have like a making of interview, you know, to have to underline the process behind what you see, like the final product, the interview itself. So you have a political personality or whatever, a guy being interviewed by someone. But you also have on a website kind of a making of a picture, making of just static pictures of the whole process, not only him being interviewed, but interacting with, I don't know, the makeup girl, or, you know, how to being rigged with a microphone and sitting on the environment, how the environment is look like, not only on the camera composition, you know, because you see the wider environment and you realize how, let's say, how those people are trying to make that thing looking good or different, or for the sake of the people being interviewed. Everybody's paying attention and trying to make a high quality job.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, they are, because viewers are viewing just backstage more.
Yeah, sure. They're just to show them what you want to show. Otherwise, they're not aware of what's happened in backstage, which sometimes is more interesting than the interview itself or the what you're trying to make it there. I'm saying especially, that because.
Yeah, especially for the web.
Yeah, that's why I'm saying it. For the web, I think it's going to be more appealing and more interesting for everyone to see what will happen behind the scenes, you know.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, I'm saying that because, of course, on, let's say, recently, but not so recently, this is a very old type of promoting movies. The making of became very popular. And of course, we have making ofs from very famous movies like, I don't know, Kubrick's Shining, or more than, I'm not sure about...
favorites, yeah.
The Shining, yeah. It's, so sometimes you're more interesting to see how those people are getting to that final product or the final image or picture or what they imagined about before doing it. And that's why I'm saying, especially in the journalistic world, sometimes it's more interesting to see how you got the idea and how all the things are moving around it when we show the final product, which it might be, as I told, an interview or something like, I don't know, a portrait interview or investigational interview or whatever.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Well, what else? This this movie doesn't load at all. It's not such a important thing, but let me try again. It's the one, it's already uploaded in the platform. I just wanted to review it a bit, but it's not such a important thing. Getting back to the topic from today, which is the famous depth of field and the sensor size, I think all the things, I hope they're pretty clear about how we can use the different type of cameras for different type of jobs, and how finally the results are very, there's a big influence of the final results from the camera we're going to use. And of course, starting with a basic point and shoot camera, even with a smartphone cameras, and then with not so expensive mirrorless camera, and then DSLR if someone really wants to invest in photo equipment. But I think, as I told you before, the usually mirrorless cameras, they are very, very good on how the quality of the picture it's deliver those days. And I will show you an example of how mirrorless camera was used in the movie production. Let me just find okay. So this is a movie which was presented in the 66 Berlin competition. And I'm not sure if I'm going full screen, I think we're gonna lose something, but I'll try to make it full screen. So it's a Portugal something production. So the so it was fully shot with the DSLR camera, which actually it's not a DSLR, it's a mirrorless finally. So as a choices of how the production has been defined, we have of course different type of cameras and productions and possibilities to shoot it on film or on a digital story, and they choose to shoot it on, I will get, that was 7 week production, whatever, and they shot it on this camera, Sony Alpha 7S, which is not a very high quality camera for cinema for a cinema let me get to that thing here. Okay. So they decided to shoot it black and white. That's why I just came with the idea of how to, what about doing the making of for the backstage part of the interview by making it looking different. Yeah, of course, all the references came from, sometimes the references can came from pictures, from paintings, or even from different photographs, yeah, or even movies, like it's in here, from Kalatazov, Sokurov, Fritz Lang, and so on and so forth. Because the visual references are very important in when you're trying to build a visual story in a movie, or sometimes even in documentaries, there are references about how the visual will tell the story about the things we're trying to tell there. And of course, the lighting is very important, and the type of lighting and how you can emphasize all the elements. As I told you, you can see here, the lights emphasize the subject, yeah? And the subject is very well lit, even if it's not a frontal lit, therefore looks even better like that, because it's a side lit and shows how the character it's thinking and so on and so forth. So it's about a war in Angola, I think, and it's tell by this lieutenant, and I don't know what rank it has, but it's one of the officers in the story here. So again, of course, the lighting, it's telling the story differently. As you can feel here, he's the brightest person in at the table, yeah, our character. And sometimes it's very hard to make that in a movie, in a picture, in the photo, it's very easily. So this is the cameras I told you, and they, of course, they make a little very cumbersome things to make it work, because it's a photo camera, it's not a cinema camera, and they try to make it work on this environment. Also, an important step in how the picture we're going to look like, it's of course the post-production, and how the picture, which was of course shot in color, will be then transformed in black and white. Yeah, and this is the result I'm going to show at the end of the deal. And the references from color to black and white, and how they started from of course the color video, and then reduced the saturation, and then added little things to the picture to make it look differently. And as you can see, it's if you look at the color capture picture, it looks very flat, but it looks flat because they wanted to look flat, and then bring all the informations back, and having the all the details they want to have it there on you see in the blacks, and add a little more texture to the blacks with the film grain. There's a plugin who looks, if you look at the skin tone and the background, you see the differences between one and the other one. It look like it's a little sharper, but it's sharper with texture. It's not just flat like before. And this is sometimes a way of making it looking different. Anyway, this is the whole story of the how they make the whole thing happened. So because of those two domains, photo and video, or film and photo, have been very close together lately because of the digital technology. It also makes the transition to some movies being shot with mirrorless cameras. And they didn't make it because they didn't have enough budget to shoot it on proper cameras. They've done it because aesthetically they thought that's going to be a better approach to show that story, and with the tools which the photo camera can make it. The examples are not so many, unfortunately, but because we have it, we can show it and discuss about it. Sometimes a small camera or a very cheap and inexpensive camera can make very nice and spectacular pictures. And that's sometimes is because the guy who's using it knows how to make all this, let's say, not so well the features of the camera work in favor of him, not to destroy what he will try to make it. So it's a whole discussion about how we use the tools to express what we want to express, instead of trying to using the latest tools just for the sake of I don't know, making selfies and promote yourself on social media, which sometimes it's the case, but is not what I usually say about how to choose a camera to shoot on, just if it's the latest one and the most expensive one. Sometimes this is not the case for making something memorable. I've been watching a movie those days. I've been to the cinema, and it's called Persian Lessons. I don't know if you saw it. It's about, of course, the Second World War. And I remember how difficult it was for, we still have some photographs from Auschwitz, and how difficult for the photographer those days has to keep the negative till someone could take it out from the Auschwitz and process it, and how valuable those images are those days. And despite the camera they use it, which wasn't really a camera, it was a very let's say improper camera, it was a what do you call it, they didn't have any lenses. They use the camera obscura property of a black box, and they make these photos from inside the Auschwitz. So those photographs are very valuable today. Even they've been done with improper cameras and devices, but tell a story about what happened there and how we have to remember those days. And it wasn't about which kind of camera you want to use or how that picture will show the viewer is going to be very let's say impressed about those pictures. Anyway, well, not sure if I having that much to tell about this first topic, but if you still have some questions, I will happily answer to it. Rezi.
No, nothing. Everything was clear.
Sorry. Anyone else? I think we'll, at the end of the week, we have a form to fill or something. Raluca, is that correct?
What do you mean?
There's going to be a form for that thing, whatever. I will clarify this.
Okay.
The test? Questions for the test?
The questionnaire. About,
they will be, it will be uploaded on the platform. The quiz is as you had it for the other module. The quiz is for the other modules. After three Zoom meetings, we have a questionnaire
with three questions and
will be uploaded on the platform for the participants.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nothing complicated, don't worry.
I'm sure about it.
Kind of the question, is that correct that the camera has a lens on it or?
Anyway. Or should it have to be a camera?
Do you need a battery to power the camera on? No. Anyway, so I think we can resume this meeting today, where we still have 4 minutes, or how much you want to. I think Raluca has a little problem with that. Anyway, well, we can resume it now.
Yeah, I think you're done for today.
Yeah, and we see each other Friday at 1 o'clock, I think, isn't it? Yeah.
Thank Friday you.
Talk with composition and different topics.
Thank you, Alex. So yep, see you Friday.
All. Yep, see you all Friday.
Goodbye.
Thank you. See you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Mm-hmm.